1 Peter 3:18 through 22. As this unfolds, there's a couple of things that we're going to see. I titled this sermon, A Clear Conscience. You know, how many like a clear conscience? Amen, right? It's the worst thing to do is to be like this all the time. Right? Or how about this? You have your cell phone. I don't have my cell phone. Who's got a cell phone? Is it on? Yeah, see, everyone else is smart. Daryl's like, right here. Everybody's going, oh, I left it at home or in church. Why would I have a cell phone? And Daryl goes, is it on? And it's on. Is it on silent?
Yes, it is.
Yeah, it's on silent. Okay. It's, I know, right? It will not detect. What's the path? No, I'm kidding. And so what I find interesting too is how many here has a cell phone? Or better yet, this is a better question. How many do not have a cell phone? How many had a cell phone and lost it? Because no, I'm kidding. I don't want to know that either. But you know, on a clear conscience, if you have a clear conscience, here's one thing that you can do. And I always, whenever my phone, and I didn't realize this until it was pointed out. Every time I set my phone down, I set it down like this, right? Face up. If you can't set your phone down face up, and you got to do this all the time, I don't know that you got a clear conscience. I also tell you this, if you can't give anybody at any time your password, not give them the password, but unlock it and go here. You don't have a clear conscience, right? And I know I'm not talking about anybody in here. I mean, I get that. But one of the key things today is the cell phone is a dead giveaway on if you got a clear conscience. If the phone rings and you're like, oh. Or you're like, okay. I got to go to the bathroom. Right? I mean, I'm just saying, this right here, if you want to know if someone has a clear conscience, pay attention to how they pay attention to their cell phone. Boy, that will stamp guilty on the forehead in a heartbeat. Clear conscience. Peter talks about a clear conscience. He gives Christ as the example, and he kind of unfolds this. And so for me to help you to understand what's going on in this passage, I'm going to have to go back into some manners and customs and what was going on in the day that created this passage to be written by Peter in the first place. That was like 1 Peter. Never mind. So when we look at this, let's go into 18, and it says, for Christ also suffered once for sins, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God. And then last week or 2 weeks ago, I stopped right there. I preached on the salvation of Jesus, what it meant, why Jesus had to die on the cross, what was going through his mind, if you will, like this whole thing that was happening with Jesus and who he was, why he died on the cross. And then Peter rolls in and he says in the second half, and this is where we're going to be pick up. And by the way, to understand verse 18, 19, or 18 through 22, you would have to go back and look at verses 13 through 17. We're not going to do that for sake of time. But it says, for Christ also suffered once for sins, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God. This is why he suffered or died on the cross, is so that we would have a way to God the Father, right? And we talked about it, and salvation is through Jesus and Jesus alone. You can't buy your way there. You can't be good enough. You can't do good enough. You can't be kind enough. You can't rescue enough animals, squirrels, whatever. Like, I was reading a thing, and because I get home and I discovered I have a mouse in my garage. Now, the last time I discovered I had a mouse in my garage, it ended up being 13 mice in my garage. And it's when I get home, I'm looking in the front of my garage door and I see all these little tracks, right? And they're running back and forth in front of the garage door. And then all of a sudden they stop and I look, and sure enough, there's a little hole like that where they ate through the rubber seal that closes the door. And I went, man, I got, okay, not a problem. So I ordered the greatest mouse trap that was ever created. Let's see if it is. Anyway, I'll find out. It'll come in the mail tomorrow. if I get a mailbox up. And so this is going to be a good day. Amen. But as I'm reading and I'm researching the best mousetrap I could get. And by the way, just so you guys know, if there's any question, I have no plans on saving this mouse. Just for the record, he's going to become food. He's going to become food for some wild thing in the backyard, and we just keep feeding him. Anyway, so I'm on there and I'm reading, and this guy writes this huge article of why he bought this mouse trap, and the fact that he killed a mouse, and he's like, Lord, forgive me. I did 10 Hail Marys and 5 fathers and whatever else they do, and the beads, and rub the color off. And he was like, you know, I'm hoping that I'm going to have salvation, right? And that killing these innocent chipmunks, and which, by the way, chipmunk, squirrel, all of that is nothing but a glorified rat. And so anyway, he's like, I killed all this. And he's so concerned with his salvation. And he goes, so now I got this mouse trap that I can catch them live and take them and let them be someone else's problem instead of mine. And so his whole thing is like, now I'll be right with God because I'm not killing God's creatures anymore. Let me help you. God says we have dominion over all the animals and beasts of the field and insects. Kill them, eat them, to God be the glory. And so I know some of you are like, I don't like where this is going. I just threw it in because I haven't preached in 2 weeks and I need to get it out. And so anyway, salvation, right? And he's talking about this whole salvation thing. And I'm here to tell you, verse 18 says, because Jesus died on the cross, he's the only way to heaven. And if you save the mice and the chipmunks and spare the cat kebabs, you're still not going to heaven if you haven't asked Jesus Christ to be your Lord and Savior. That was the whole reason for that rant. Now we get into the second half, and it says, being put to death in the flesh, but made alive to the Spirit. And so we see that in 18 through 22, Peter's going to illustrate the principles that were given to us in 13 through 17, where we see Christ is provided as the perfect example, not just because and by the way, I'm not telling anyone to go out here and die on the cross because you can't save anyone. But I will say this, that if you're persecuted because of the cross, don't be afraid to die. Because in Christ, we live forever. Amen. And so I want you to see that Christ provided the perfect example. He suffered for doing what was right. And then in this, his sinless life provoked the unjust hostilities of evil men. And have you ever noticed if you're doing right, people all of a sudden can get angry at you, or they'll do this. Oh, you're such a goody two-shoe. Right? And now they're trying to make you feel bad because you're doing what's right. Oh, you won't join the rest of us. Oh, because you're better than us. And it's usually just like, no, I'm just smarter. Right? I don't want to pay the fine because I have wisdom now because I was that silly before. And I don't want to relive it. Right? And what am I doing? I'm saving my conscience. How am I saving my conscience? I'm not searing it with sin against God. And so Jesus is setting the example here that he dies on the cross. Peter says, listen, he's our only way of salvation. But here's the example that he sets. And as we go on, you're going to see that he does this and even talks about baptism and why we're to be baptized. And so here he says, being put to death. I want you to see that God, Jesus, first off, was not moved by sinful men, even though they got hostile toward him. The second thing I want you to see is that Jesus did not fear men, but he trusted God. And I remember when he's standing before Pilate and Pilate said, don't you understand? Don't you understand? I have the power to take your life or to give you life. And you got nothing to say to me. And Jesus says, you only have what my Father in heaven has given to you. Don't get so excited. Okay, that was my added part, right? But he was like, listen, you can't do anything. You can do nothing but what my Father has given you permission to do. He didn't fear men. And I want you to know, guys, we don't need to fear men. We don't need to walk in fear. We don't need to surrender the freedoms that God has given to us because of Jesus' death on the cross, because man says, surrender it. And so as we go through this, what we're going to see is that Jesus did not fear men, that he trusted God, and that Jesus clearly stated his purpose and committed himself to what he said he would do, and that is to die on the cross. And he died in our place, keeping his conscience clear. And you say, what? Keeping his conscience clear? Yeah, because, you know, anytime we go against God, we now have a guilty conscience toward God, not just toward man, but toward God himself. By the way, you know, we can sin against someone, but ultimately, who are we sinning against? We're sinning against God. Now, we still need to make it right with the person that we've done wrong, but the reality is that we have sinned against God. In 1 Peter 2, verse 23, do you have that up? 1 Peter 2, 23, it says this, who, when he was reviled, did not revile in return. When he suffered, he did not threaten, but committed himself to him who judges righteously. See, Jesus had a clear conscience, if you will, toward the Father, because no matter what happened, he stuck to his commitment, and his commitment was to die for you and me. And he went under pressure. I mean, I don't know if you realize, but spikes run through your hand, that's a little pressure. Spikes run through your feet, that's a little pressure. Hanging on the cross until you can't breathe and your lungs fill up with liquid, there's a little bit of pressure. We know his lungs filled up with liquid because if you remember, he's on the cross and a soldier took a spear and stabbed him in the side, and what came out but blood and water? Well, he stabbed him in the lung to see if he was dead. And so he literally drowned in his own fluid on the cross. I'm just thinking that's a little uncomfortable. And he knew what it would be, because this isn't the first time that someone died on the cross. It's just the first time our Savior died on the cross. If you remember in the garden, Jesus even said to the Father three times, Lord, Father, if there's any other way to take this cup from me, do it. Nevertheless, not my will be done, but your will be done. And guys, if you're going to have a clear conscience with God, that's where we got to land. Nevertheless, Father, not my will be done, but your will be done. And if we allow man to persuade us from that which God has called us, we will not have a clear conscience with God. And so Jesus is just setting the standard, if you will. And as a result of dying on the cross, or keeping, if you will, a clear conscience with God, that he was rewarded. And we're going to look at that in verse. Let me pull this up here again. In verse 19. Or 18. Let's go back to verse 18, the second half. Being put to death in the flesh, but made alive by the Spirit, by whom also he went and preached to the spirits in prison. Man, how much I wanted to jump past these verses. But the minute I jump past the verses, someone would go, I thought you were going verse by verse. What happened? And then I had to back up and apologize and then preach on it anyway. And so I thought, well, I just might as well hang in the pocket. Amen. And so when we see this in 18, that being put to death in the flesh, but made alive by the Spirit. In some places, they say that this was Jesus who he died in the flesh, but his spirit was still alive. And they'll tell you that. And I don't agree with that. And yet this is what some will teach. And I'm not bashing on anyone. I'm just saying, and I'm about to tell you why I believe what I believe. Amen. And so they say, no, this is just the spirit. His spirit lives, right? But the problem that I have with is that, Romans 8:11, if you will go to Romans chapter 8, verse 11, it says this, but if the spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his spirit who dwells in you. And so who raised Christ from the dead but the Holy Spirit? And so I just want to bring clarity to this. And some of you might go, well, I wasn't confused about it. Or some of you go, well, it doesn't matter. But it really does matter if Christ is setting the example, keeping a clear conscience, and he dies, and the Spirit of God raises him up, the very same Spirit is going to raise us up, which means we should not be afraid, and we need to keep a clear conscience with God. Amen. You see how it all connects? Someone say amen. Anybody else get that? Say amen. There you go. All right. And so I want you to see that he was made alive by the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of God, according to Romans 8:11. And guys, if we stay true to God and we keep a clear conscience with God, it's the Holy Spirit who will not only do that work in us and through us, but also the Holy Spirit who will raise us. Okay. Then I want you to see in verse 19, and boy, this is an interesting one, right? Verses 19 and 20, by whom also he went and preached to the spirits in prison. And remember, Jesus dies on the cross. He goes to the grave. He preaches to the spirits in prison, and then he's raised on the third day, and he's at the right hand of the Father. And so as we look at this, he preached to the spirits in prison. And I'm going to tell you guys, this one right here, if I would had hair when I started researching this, I would have ended up looking like this at the end. Because it's a difficult passage. And I told my wife, I go, I don't want to preach it. I don't even want to talk about it. Act like it doesn't exist. Go on to 21. Right. But me who being me and a glutton for punishment, let's hang in there and dig a hole. So let's go with this one. And we're going to find out who did Jesus preach to the spirits in prison? Who were those? And some believe that that Peter here, he referred to the descent of Christ's spirit in the Hades between his death and his resurrection to offer people who lived before the flood, a second chance for salvation, right? Because it talks about in Noah's day. And so he goes down and he preaches to them to give them a second chance of salvation. But here's a problem is there's nothing in scripture that teaches us that you have a second opportunity for salvation, except the only thing that we have that teaches us that we have a second opportunity for salvation is the Catholic Church, right? There's purgatory. So if you mess up here, you go to purgatory, and then when you go to purgatory, another sinner is going to pray you out, right? And they're going to go every other day and pay $2 to light a candle in your name or in representation of you to pray you out. Let me just say this without bashing anyone. That is non-existent. It's a man-made tradition. It's a heretic, cultic attitude toward the scriptures. It doesn't exist. So to say that Jesus went to the grave to preach to those who died in Noah's day is wrong. It's just wrong. There's nowhere in scripture. And here's how we know that Jesus didn't need to go back to them and preach to them, because it says that Noah preached to them, and he preached to them in the spirit. In other words, the Holy Spirit spoke through Noah, and Noah presented to the lost people of that time who Jesus was, or who God was, and the need to be in heaven to believe in Jesus Christ, or the Messiah that was coming, to believe in God, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And they refused to believe in that God, and they all died in perished. So why would Jesus go back and go, see, it was me. He was telling the truth. So I'm going to give you another opportunity. It does not fit scripture anywhere. So that one we have to throw out. And some of you might go, hey, I'm Catholic, or I came from a Catholic background. Listen, guys, I'm not trying to bash anyone, but if someone doesn't tell the truth, then who's going to know the truth? That's all I'm saying, that the what the Catholic Church teaches on purgatory is wrong. On every level, it is wrong. It is Satan's way of saying, well, listen, if you mess up here, your mama and daddy's going to love you so much, they're going to pray for you to get into heaven, so you got another chance. Don't worry about it. Do what you want. That's what that belief does. Purgatory simply gives you a belief to continue on in your lifestyle because there's another way out. And there is no other way out. You draw your last breath here, you're done. Wherever you decided while you're alive today, that is your eternal state forever. If you notice, eternal and forever is kind of the same thing. Spelled different, but the same. And so I can't have you believing a false cultic teaching. Then others have said that this passage refers to Christ's descent into hell after his crucifixion to proclaim his victory to the imprisoned fallen angels that are referred to in 2 Peter 2, 4 through 5. If you'll go to that real quick, 2 Peter. So if you notice, I like to bring up scripture anytime I'm talking about it. And if you notice, I had zero scripture for purgatory. That's why I didn't bring it up. Just to help you understand, there's none there. But this belief, it says here, for if God did not spare the angels who sinned, but cast them down to hell and delivered them in the chains of darkness to be reserved for judgment, and did not spare the ancient world, but saved Noah, one of eight people, a preacher of righteousness, bringing in the flood on the world of the ungodly. Listen, I'm just going to tell you, as you look at this and we see that the angels are already set aside for judgment. The people of Noah's day, they were already set. They're already set aside for judgment. And you're like, Pastor, do you believe in heaven and hell? Oh, absolutely. Where do we go when we die? Oh, my goodness. That is a loaded question. And I will say this. I'll leave it alone. Okay. So then if you go into Genesis 6, 1 and 2, Genesis 6, 1 and 2. So now it came to pass when men began to multiply on the face of the earth and daughters were born to them, that the sons of God saw the daughters of men, that they were beautiful, and they took wives for themselves, all of whom they chose. These are believed to be the Nephilim. The Nephilim are fallen angels, which are now demons. And so if it's an angel, that means that it's still good and the angel's good and the angel is with God. If they've chosen to leave God, they're now considered demons. And these demons would be these ones, the sons of God who have fallen, and then they had sex with human women and created an offspring, which created the giants in the land. And like this whole thing goes on, and God destroys these giants in the land because their minds were set on evil continually. And the only ones that were saved were Noah and his family. And so God comes in and he wipes out all of these. And so some say that these are the ones, the sons of God, the fallen angels, that they're the ones that God went into the grave and he preached to. Well, I have a problem with that, because Jesus doesn't need to go to angels who have already seen him, who've already been with him in heaven, for him to go, nah, 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 told you I was here. Like, he doesn't have to do that. He is the Son of God. They knew he was the Son of God. They knew he couldn't die. They knew he couldn't be beat. They knew who he was. We see it through the scriptures where Jesus comes up and he's going to cast them out and the demons out of the man. And if you remember, they're like, I know who you are. Don't send me into nothing. Let us go into the pigs. They knew who he was. So why would he have to go and preach to them who he was? So I struggle with that interpretation. I mean, it could be true, but I just struggle with it. And then some say, well, he went and preached that the spirit references humans rather than angels. And usually the term applied to supernatural beings. And then at least once to humans. And so some say it is the humans. If we go to Hebrews 12, 23. And to the general assembly and church of the firstborn who are registered in heaven to God, the judge of all, to the spirits of just men made perfect. So this is a reference to humans. 1 Peter 3:20 talks about Jesus going in and preaching to the disobedient. I'm going to say this, and everything I just said, I don't know where to land on this. But it's quite, every bit of it's questionable of who he actually went and preached to. And look, he could have went and preached to those of the days of Noah because they are the people, because they were disobedient. But so were the sons of God who were the fallen angels. They were in Noah's day and they were disobedient. And the giants in the land were disobedient. And so let me just tell you this. If we look at the giants in the land, or we look in the people of days of Noah, I don't care who it is, Jesus went into prison and he said what he said for whatever reasons he had. And who he talked to, I don't know, is as important as what he said. And since we don't have record of what he said, here's what we have to know and we hold on to. That Jesus is the Son of God. And he doesn't have to justify anything he does to anyone. And this is just added information. And we could have a really fun debate over this and go through all the scriptures. And I don't know that we're really going to land in any specific spot except for Jesus is God and he has power over the grave. Amen. That's where we're going to land. Because it could fit that he preached to the lost, but I don't think he preached to the lost for salvation. I don't think he preached to the angels to say, here I am. I told you I would do this. Looky, look. I don't think he did that because he wouldn't have to, because Jesus simply makes the statement, I am. I mean, Buck's sermon last week, right? I am. I am the I am. And I don't need a reason or I don't need to justify it. I am the I am. And that's what we accept here, that Jesus went to the grave and he preached to the spirits, whatever he preached to the spirits in prison. And we know it was those who formerly were disobedient. Look here in verse 20, who formerly were disobedient when once the divine long suffering waited in the days of Noah while the ark was being prepared, in which a few, that is eight souls, were saved through water. When we look at those who were disobedient, it could be any of those. It could have been the fallen angels, the sons of God that Genesis talks about, the people of Noah that refused to listen. But just know this, Jesus has power over the grave. And then we get into verse 20. Yeah, I'm going to jump. Guys, I know that I gave you two other verses, Genesis 6, 3 and 6, 5 through 9. We're going to go ahead and skip that. Just so you keep up with me on the passages, right? All right, so if we go into verse 20, it says, who formerly were disobedient when once the divine long-suffering waited in the days of Noah while the ark was being prepared, in which a few, that is eight souls, were saved through water. Now, I want you to see this, that this saved through water is not baptism. It's not baptism in this passage of 20. Guess what it was? It was rainwater. And guess how they were saved? They floated in the ark on rainwater. They were saved by water, because had they not been in the ark floating on top of the water and God not spared them and killed the rest of the world, there might not have been any saved and repenting of their sins. And so the saved by water in this verse is simply the rainwater, the flood water that came. Then we look into verse 21, and this is how we know that in verse 20, by the way, please put up 20 up here for me, if you'll do that. 3:20, 1 Peter. And then we're going to go to 21, so be ready for 21 if you would, sir. So here in 20, because I want you to see, some of you are looking at me like a deer in headlights. Who formerly were disobedient when once the divine long-suffering waited in the days of Noah while the ark was being prepared, in which a few, that is eight, Noah and his family, souls were saved through water, not baptism here. And the reason that it's not baptism, we know it's not baptism, is because in verse 21, and I love how scripture, I wish scripture would have clarified the prison, but it didn't. So here we're going to look in 21 on baptism. And here in 21, it says, there is also an antitype which now saves us, baptism. Now, if you stop there, you would go, wait a minute, if baptism saves us, why do we need Jesus? Right? So we don't want to stop there. We want to keep reading. So here we go. It says, not the removal of the filth of the flesh. I love that, right? Listen, baptism, not the removal of the filth of the flesh. In other words, baptism didn't save you from the filthy flesh that you and I have. And that's that sinfulness that dwells in us. Amen. But what does it mean? But the answer of a good conscience toward God. Of course, how does that happen? Through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. So leave that verse up there for me, if you will, just for a moment. So when we look at this, it says, but not the removal of the filth of flesh. So in other words, baptism does not save us for salvation. What was going on here, and if you remember, and I don't think I put this on, but don't worry about it, man. Let's see here. Let me scroll, because I'm talking faster than I'm going with my notes. I can't leave my notes behind, right? All right, so... okay, so what I want you to see here is the baptism... that says, but the answer of good conscience toward God. What was going on back in the day? And if you remember in Acts 2:38, now in Acts 2:38, denominations teach that baptism is salvation, or salvation is through baptism, right? Where Peter says in Acts 2:38, repent and be baptized for the what? Forgiveness of your sins, or for the remission of your sins. And so if you look at that passage, you would go, wait a minute, salvation is through baptism. Peter says it there, but then Peter says here, not the removal of the filth of the flesh, but the answer of a good conscience toward God. Wait a minute, what does baptism actually mean? I'm glad you guys asked. So here's what baptism means. A good conscience toward God. What was going on back in the day in the book of Acts? And remember, the book of Acts is all about the beginning of the church. If you want to know how the church of God, the church of Christ specifically, not Jehovah's Witness, but of Jesus Christ, the real church, was started, the book of Acts talks all about it. The book of Acts is literally the action of the building of the church through the disciples. That would be the book of Acts in one sentence. And so when Peter writes in there, repent and be baptized for the remission of your sins, what he was doing was he was countering the culture. And what I mean by that is, at that time, a lot of people were being persecuted for believing in Jesus Christ. And when I mean persecuted, I mean they lost all of their family, they lost their fortune, they were kicked out of town, they had to run and hide, they lost their life with everything except for their breath, because they believed in Jesus. So what that started was, they said, oh, wait a minute, the only way they can identify us as believers is through baptism. So, because baptism is what? It's public. And they're like, oh my goodness, so if we get baptized, then the public's going to see that we know Jesus. And if we know Jesus, we're going to pay the price. So don't get baptized. Believe in Jesus, but leave baptism out. That's what was going on. And so when Peter says in the book of Acts, hey, repent. Repent for the removal of the filth of the flesh, because you're sinful, and be baptized, that's for a clear conscience, so that you aren't hiding. Oh, who knows? I got saved. Okay, nobody here, so I can, I can live like the world, because there's nobody saved here. And what happens is, you no longer have a clear conscience toward God, because you're hiding your belief in Jesus. Right? Remember, can I have your phone, sir? Remember the phone? We turn it down. Why? Because we're hiding. Not everyone, but most. If it doesn't apply to you, don't beat me up later over it. Just flip your phone up. Or we get a call or a text. Ooh, what? Ooh. Better turn this on silent when nobody's looking. Right? The way you treat your phone when people are around is the way the Christian was treating God through with baptism when people were around. Let me just hide it. And so Peter says this, listen, I'm going to tell you, don't hide Jesus. Don't hide Jesus. And your baptism is the answer of a good conscience, meaning that, yep, you know what? I am who I am. I am a child of God. I'm going to die. I'm going to go to heaven. Jesus Christ is my Lord and Savior. And I am so saved, I can swing over hell on a cornstalk singing Amazing Grace, How Sweet the Sound. That's what I'm talking about. And that's what he's talking about, this clear conscience toward God. The day is coming where somebody's going to come up to you and go, do you love Jesus Christ? Yep. And that day you're going to have to decide. And getting baptized is your public profession of Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. It is the outward expression of your inward condition that you're a child of God. And so when Peter says that there is an antitype which now saves us, baptism, which saves us from what? Having a clear conscience of who God is to us, in God, a clear conscience that I can clearly go, there is no mistaking that I am a child of God, and there is no mistake in me of anyone that talks to me that I am a child of God, because if you let me have 5 minutes with you, in the first minute and a half to 2 minutes, I'm going to bring God into the picture. Why? Because I have a clear conscience toward God. I'm a child of his. And he's talking here because remember, Peter wrote in the book of Acts, repent and be baptized. In other words, he's saying, if you're not willing to get baptized, then you don't believe in Jesus Christ. And I'm not going to take this sorry excuse. So people, I'll do this. People say, Pastor, this is a beautiful example. Pastor, why do you call people up front if they've been saved? That's you're really putting them on the spot. Oh no. No, no. You know what I'm doing for you? You're welcome. I'm giving you a clear conscience. You can't sit in your chair and go, you gotta stand. Here I am. Clear conscience. I know, some of you are waiting on me to fall like the last time, huh? How many were waiting? Be honest. That's what I thought, yeah. Well, this time I got shoes on that fit. So, for those of you who don't know, I'll quickly share because now you're not going to listen until you know, so I'll help you. I had on, I think they called them metrosexual shoes. I think is what they called them. I'm not sure, but what it is, you know, your foot is only this long, right? But the shoes make it look this long. But your toes stop here, but the shoe doesn't. And I found these shoes brand new, leather, nice shoe for $25 on sale at Penny's on clearance. I'm that guy. I'm like, I'll wear them. They're $25. I don't care what they look like. So one day I was getting excited and I was going to step up on the chair. And I knew where my toes stopped, but I forgot where the shoes stopped. And so as I go to step, the shoe hits the front of the chair, but my momentum is still going. And so I would have ended up chair back in your lap, giving you a big old hug. And if you would have been a female, you'd been like, and me being a male would have been like, and it would have been a train wreck, but that's what happened. And so now you guys know the rest of the story. So here we go. You just got to know what's going on. Amen. All right. So here, when we see this, we see that baptism was their public conscience clearing is what Peter's referencing. If you believe in God, people are going to know it. Amen. You're not going to hide it. And today, so many Christians are all about hiding. Let me hide so I can keep my job. Let me hide so nobody will be mad at me. Let me hide so I'm not going to offend someone. Let me hide because I know their lifestyle is completely different than mine. But if I show them my lifestyle, it's going to offend their lifestyle. So we'll support their lifestyle by being silent. But baptism, what Peter's talking about, is your public stand with Jesus Christ, knowing they knew if they got baptized, their life as they knew it was over. Persecution is coming. The loss of business, the loss of family, the loss of home, the loss of town, the loss of city, the loss of identity is gone. As a matter of fact, in the book of Acts, if you read in chapter 15 and then go into chapter 16, James, who is the brother of Jesus, but he is the main guy in Jerusalem, like he was the pastor of the Jerusalem church. And James tells Paul, after they had this huge argument about, can a Gentile get saved like a Jew can get saved? Did God open the gospel to everyone? This was going on in Acts chapter 15. And when they finally surrendered and solidified that Christ opened the gospel up to the Jew and the Gentile, being you and I. And then James says this, because Paul was getting ready to go on another journey to build another church to tell people about Jesus. And James says, Paul, remember the poor. Remember the poor. And Paul said, man, I will gladly remember the poor. Well, if you look in the scriptures, it's not the poor of the world. It was the poor Christians who lost everything because they identified with Christ through baptism, but they had a clear conscience. They might have been broke, but they had a clear conscience. And Paul said, I will gladly remember the poor. I will gladly take up money, alms, and give to the poor. Not the poor of the world. He was talking about the poor Christian who lost everything because they had a clear conscience, because they stood for Jesus. And so don't get entangled up in that the church is supposed to run and rescue all the poor. We're supposed to give the poor the gospel. And if we can help, that's fine. And if we can't, we move on. But the poor that the Bible's talking about is the Christian who lost everything. And if you don't believe me, research it, please. Why were they poor? And why did Paul have to help them? Why did James say help the poor? Because they got baptized. And that was the answer of a good conscience toward God. And I'm just going to tell you, if you're going to have a good conscience toward God and you've not been baptized, you need to get baptized. And if you're silent, you need to break your silence of Jesus. If you're going to have the good conscience toward God, you can't be silent in fear of losing something. And that's the whole purpose of this example that Peter's writing about. Look at Christ. Yes, if you look at him through the eyes of the world, he was a man that lost everything. You know what? He lost everything and he died on the cross, and it was a senseless death because he could have lived. And why did he die? It just doesn't make sense. But man, to Jesus, he's like, if I don't do this, nobody lives. And then God honors him. And I'm going to tell you, if you're silent with the gospel, nobody lives. Do you know how I got saved? Someone was bold enough to preach the gospel to someone like me who was just hard-hearted, and I could cut your heart out and not care. Who would come up to me? I had eyes that would intimidate everyone, I was told. Who would come up to me? And yet someone loved Jesus. They couldn't be quiet, and they knew I needed Jesus. And so they tell me. Now here I am today to tell you, whew, because someone had a good conscience toward God and didn't want to see me go to hell. Didn't even know me, didn't even like me. But they couldn't be quiet. And guys, that's why I can't be quiet. I can't be quiet. Because if I'm quiet, I don't have a good conscience toward God. And you're never going to hear the truth. And then you won't have an opportunity to go to heaven. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. How else are you going to believe except for someone tell you? Man, there have been times where in the most awkward places, God's like, you need to tell them about Jesus. And I'm going, you can't find a better time than this, Lord. Anybody ever been there? You already know this isn't going to go well, or you think. And then you tell someone about Jesus because God said to do it and you want to be obedient, right? And so then you tell someone about Jesus and you get done and you're like, oh, Lord, I might as well talk to that rock outside. Amen? Amen. And then a few days later, I get a phone call or I get a visit. Hey, remember what you said? Or how about this? I did a podcast when I was in Florida. I did a podcast with Duke. He and I, he had met a gentleman named Ernie, 22 years old. This dude is sharp as a tack, man. I mean, when you hear him talk, he understands, but he's lost. As Pastor Brothers would say, lost is Hogan's goat. I don't know who Hogan is, and I don't know about his goat, but that's a saying, right? I actually looked it up and it's a real saying. And I went, okay, whatever. Anyway, he's lost his Hogan's goat. And so we had him on the podcast because we were just going to talk to him about what the it's Gen Z, right? That's the 20-year-old generation, Gen Z. And I had to look it up because I thought you guys were still millennials. I don't mean that in a negative. I don't know what I mean. Anyway, so we talked to him and then as we go through this, and he said, he made a statement. He goes, listen, if I'm going to stand in the world and know that my government is against me and my government's trying to take over the world and trying to kill this country, and I'm not going down without a fight. And I'm like, this is a 22-year-old saying this. Dude, I love you, right? And then he said, so if I'm going to make a difference, I have to grow in three areas. Knowledge, finances, and spirituality. That's what I said. I was like, dude, man, how old did you say you were? And so as we talked about the politics side of it, of the knowledge, and we glazed over the financial side part of it. And then I said, Ernie, I got a question for you. And it'll be on the podcast. It'll be up Tuesday if you want to listen to it. I said, I have a question for you. Do you believe in heaven and hell? And he goes, yeah. Good and evil? Yeah. How do you get to heaven? Just for a moment, it was silent. So how do you get to heaven? And he said, well, you have to be a good person. I said, I knew you were going to say that. Because your age works on works. Like you think that you got to go and do a bunch of good stuff to do anything to make a difference. But let me tell you, your good works are not going to get you to heaven. Because here's my next question. If good works get you to heaven, how good is good enough? And then before you answer that one, let me ask you another question. By whose standard? And he was like, oh, those are good questions. And then we moved on. I didn't get an answer, and that was okay. We moved on. What you didn't hear, that's not on the podcast if you choose to listen to it. Because after we finished the podcast, I said, Ernie, I'm not done with my conversation. If you don't mind, I'd like to finish it. And he goes, oh, man, I love this. What? And I go, heaven. How do you get to heaven? I'm patient. Sorry. I'm kidding. I said, how do you get to heaven? I said, Ernie, you can't earn your way. Let me just help you. And I tell him about Jesus, and I tell him how he dies on the cross. And I said, listen, here's what I want you to do, because, man, you're an intelligent guy, and you read and you research, and I know you're going to research this. And so here's what I want you to do. I want you to go to John chapter 3, and I want you to read the book of John, but I really want you to focus on John chapter 3, and I really want you to focus on his discussion with Nicodemus, who was a religious ruler. He had religion, and Ernie, you have religion, and I don't want you to have religion. Religion will send you to hell. So then a few days go by. By this time, I'm home, and I get a call from Pastor Duke. Man, I'm not going to get through all this. Yeah, I will. So at any rate, I and a longer clock. And so so Pastor Duke calls me up, and he's like, hey, I just talked to Diane. And you're like, who's Diane, right? Good question. Ernie's sister. And so it's talking to Diane, and Diane is telling him, hey, thank you so much for reaching out to Ernie. I've been praying for him, because she's a Christian, and I've been praying for him, and so on and so forth. And he called me, and he's like, she said, Pastor John really challenged him. And Duke's like, so what happened? Challenged him with reading John, the book of John, and especially John chapter 3. And Ernie said, after he got done with John chapter 3 and realizing, he's told Diane, he goes, now I understand. Good works aren't it. Now I know. How else would Ernie have known except for someone challenged him? Someone said, hey, look, I know this isn't your belief, but check it out. Read it. Look at it. Just do whatever. How would he know except for someone told him the gospel? I have a clear conscience toward God. You know why? Because I am not ashamed of the gospel. And that's what Peter's talking about. He's talking about a clear conscience. He's talking about how baptism doesn't save you, and he's not talking about baptism here. He's talking about a clear conscience, and that baptism literally shows the world who you belong to. Because remember, the thief on the cross didn't get baptized. The thief on the cross didn't look at Jesus and go, hey, when you get to your kingdom, remember me. And Jesus is like, dude, you got to get off this thing and get wet first. Like, you're not coming into my house until you've been dipped all the way under. When that happens, call me. We'll talk. You didn't see that from Jesus. He said, remember me. And Jesus said, today, I assure you, today you will be with me in paradise. Today you'll be with me. No good works, no money, no baptism. Just straight up believing who Jesus is, the Son of God, the Savior of the world. Baptism just tells the world that you believe that. And so he goes on in 20, and finishes up in 21. So he's about the answer of a good conscience toward God through the resurrection of Jesus. It's because Jesus died and he was resurrected. That's why we can go and have a good conscience toward God. Baptism does that because of Christ's resurrection. And then we get into verse 22, and I will get this. And I know, guys, you have a ton of verses, but we're never going to get to them. And if we do get to all of them, nobody will like me anymore. So one of these days you'll get out early enough to beat the Methodist to lunch. Here we go. Oh, my goodness. 22, it says, put up 22 for me. Sorry, there you go. Thank you. You're reading my mind, or I'd already told you. I'd already told you, didn't I? I need coffee. Here we go. Who has gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God. Angels and authorities and powers have been made subject to him. Guys, I want you to see, here's what happened. Jesus is the Son of God. I get it. And Jesus, Savior of the world. I know that. And you know what, though? God honored Jesus. God honored Jesus because Jesus is obedient. Who has gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God, angels and authorities and powers having been made subject to him. And I want you to see, oh, we're going to do this, guys, and you just forgive me. You got to love me, so I'll ask you to forgive me. You got to forgive me, too. How many times? 70 times 7. Psalm 110:1. If you look, Psalm 110:1. The Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand till I make your enemies your footstool. The Lord, Yahweh, God in all his fullness, said to my Lord Jesus, sit at my right hand till I make your enemies my footstool. Hebrews 1:13. But to which of the angels has ever said, sit at my right hand till I make your enemies my footstool? Listen, Jesus is above all. Jesus was honored for what he has done. If you look in Hebrews 8:1, now this is the main point of the things we are saying. We have such a high priest who is seated at the right hand of the throne of the majesty in heavens. Hebrews 10:12. But this man, after he, Jesus, had suffered one sacrifice for sins forever, sat down at the right hand of God. Hebrews 12:2. Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy, and remember we talked about this 2 weeks ago, it was a joy for him to die for you and me. Who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. He has a seat of supreme honor to rule and reign over all creation. Colossians 1:15 and 16. Did you have that, guys? Okay, there we go. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For by him all things were created that are in heaven and that are on earth, visible and invisible, whether the thrones or dominions or principalities or powers, all things were created through him and for him. Listen, I'm telling you, he has the supreme honor. And then we see in Colossians 2:14 and 15. Having wiped out the handwriting of requirements that was against us, Jesus wiped out all that was against us. The law is not in our favor. The law doesn't save us. You know why? The law simply points out that we are in need of a savior, and the law points out that we break the law. The law points out that we are sinners. Amen? Having wiped out the handwriting of requirements that was against us, which was contrary to us, and he has taken it out of the way, having nailed it to the cross. And then verse 15, having disarmed principalities and powers, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them in it. And guys, what I want to tell you today, if you stand for Jesus and you're not ashamed of Jesus, you have a clear conscience with God through Jesus Christ, we're going to triumph over our enemies. And it may not look like it in the beginning. And it might actually cost us something. But it's not the beginning that matters. It's the end. And with Jesus, there is no end. We have eternity forever and ever. And I would rather be obedient to God and be blessed and have a clear conscience with God than to die satisfying man who can never be satisfied. Today, you need to make a decision. Some of you are going to have to make a decision to give your life to Jesus Christ. Some of you are going to have to make a decision to stand for Jesus Christ. And some of you may make that same decision today. But if we're going to have a clear conscience with God, it's a public profession. That's why I ask you guys to come forward. I'm not trying to embarrass anyone. I would never do that. Unless you were family, and then I would definitely do that. Some of your family. You have to make a decision. And that's what Peter's writing about, and that's what he's talking about in this part of this passage, in this context. Stand for God. Guys, it's not always going to be easy. There have been times in all my boldness that God has asked me to do things where I have sat back and went, Lord, you owe me for this one. Okay, Lord, take me from the street sweeper and at least give me an office, okay? I'll take that. It's not always easy, but it's necessary. Every head bowed, every eye closed, if you would. Today, I'm just going to challenge you. I'm going to challenge you that if you're here and you do not know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, that you change that today. It is the only decision in your life that promises you eternal life. And to not make a decision for Jesus Christ is a decision that promises you eternal torment. This is the only thing that matters in your entire life. With every head bowed and every eye closed, if you're here and you do not know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, I want to give you an opportunity to change that. Romans 10, 9 and 10 says, for with the heart, man believes unto Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. For with the heart, man believes that Jesus was born of a virgin, died for our sins, conquered the grave, and is at the right hand of the Father today. The heart believes that. You may not understand all of it, but you believe it. Then the Bible says, confession with the mouth is made unto salvation. If you wish to give your life to Jesus Christ, I'm going to ask you to pray this prayer quietly to yourself. The words don't save you. They're not magical. It's just simply a roadmap that walks you through and gives you a timestamp where you can say, this day, I, on purpose, surrendered my life to Jesus Christ and made him my Lord and Savior. That's all this prayer does. It just gives you a day that you can mark down in your Bible, that you can mark on the calendar, that you can put in your life that says, this day, I made a conscious decision with all of my heart to surrender my life to Jesus Christ. That's all this prayer does. And if it's your desire to surrender your life to Jesus Christ, then you quietly pray this prayer to yourself. Jesus, today, I recognize you as the Savior of the world. Today, I surrender my life to you. Today, I believe that you are the only way to heaven. I believe that you died on the cross for me and my sins. I believe that without you, it's impossible for anyone to get to heaven. I believe that you are the way, the truth, and the life. I believe today that without you and believing in my heart of hearts, all of that, I believe there's no way and no hope for me to get to heaven. You are it. So Jesus, today, I surrender all. Today, I make you my Lord and Savior. The Bible says, for with the heart man believes unto righteousness. And so if you truly believe that, not just a head thought or the head knowledge of, well, hey, if this is what he says, then I'll go ahead and I'll say this prayer, and then that way I can get to heaven. If that's your attitude, you're no further along than when you came in this morning or when you got up this morning. You're not promised heaven any more than you were before or the day you were born. It is with the heart.
We at Connecting Point Church are excited to have you join us. When you come, you'll experience a friendly, lively, and casual family-like atmosphere that welcomes you as you are. Our messages combine straightforward biblical truths, humor, and life-changing challenges for you to learn and grow in God's Word. We believe in connecting people to Christ, to the plans and gifts He has for them, and with people in our community who share these values. We also believe in reaching out to our local area and the regions beyond. We're dedicated to being a place where your entire family can believe, belong, and become all that God intends you to be. Discover the abundance of life in Jesus Christ as you begin to understand the roots of the problems and learn to apply the tools for you to triumph over your challenges today. It'll be a breath of fresh air in this unsettled world.